Good evening. I would like to thank you for giving me this chance to talk about the social and cultural developments that result from the series of protest movements that have been taking place in Iraq during the last decade. Of course, with a special emphasis on the October protests 2019. I choose as a title for my presentation or lecture, Shades of Life in Al-Tahrir Square, Freedom Square, Arts as a Means of Political Resistance, Cultural Expression, and Social Change. While collecting material for my presentation, I think of another title, that is, She is the Revolution, Activism and Artivism in the Iraqi Post-23 Protest, in direct reference to the participation of women, heavy participation of women in these protests. Of course, in my presentation, I'm talking about Iraq, the homeland of many ancient civilizations and the land of two rivers, Mesopotamia, as we say, and many prominent writers and thinkers like Ali al-Wardi, al-Mutanabbi, al-Sayyab, al-Jawahiri, Ahmed Sa'dawi, Fuad al-Kardi, and others. At the same time, it is the stage of many conflicts, wars, and tragedies, which resulted in these protests and other, let's say, problems and challenges. In my presentation, you might note that Corona and its impact is not a main issue. I would rather prefer to focus on the protest and its resulting consequences or impact on society and people in general. This is so, and this choice, because I believe that in Iraq, we have other damaging, more destructive types of corona. We have, for example, corruption corona, we have political corona, we have sectarian corona, and so on. So that is why it is not a big issue. Also, because of time limitation, I arrange my presentation in this manner. I begin with a description of my own participation in the protest. Then I move from my participation to giving an idea about the historical background that make Iraq reach this state of chaos. Then I move to focusing or shedding light on the main developments that resulted from the protest in, for example, fields of culture, social change, and political resistance. In this October, the protesters are celebrating the first anniversary of the protest that had its date of its beginning, the 2nd of October 2019. Of course, in this year, a lot of water had run under the bridge of Iraq, and we have many changes. The protests have succeeded in changing a lot, but we are waiting for more changes to take place in Iraq. The last protests that began in October 2019, in fact, are of special importance for me, as they are the first public event that in which I willingly, by my own desire, participated. What I have been through in these protests might be compared to a method in anthropology called observation by participation. I went in Al-Tahrir Square more than 20 times. There I met with my former colleagues, my former students, people I don't know. I find in this square, Iraq in all its diversity, richness, and heritage. As expected, the first few days were rather messy, as the protests themselves were very spontaneous and leaderless, but step by step, the protests gain momentum, they become more organized as more people from all social, political, cultural backgrounds poured in. I was reluctant, in fact, in the beginning to participate in these protests, and my family were horrified when they heard me, let's say, heard my decision to go there. In fact, they are partially right, and they are of the opinion, as they are of the opinion, that these events and public protests are more suitable for men than for women. Also, we have the threats in the square itself as the clashes between police forces and the protesters continue, as we have tear gas, for example, as we have live bullets launched or directed at the protesters. More than 600 people were killed. Also, we have the threat of kidnapping, of being, for example, disappeared and so on. In the square, I did not meet ordinary persons, in fact, and this is one of the most attractive, let's say, aspect in these protests. I see heroes in the true sense of the word. Each one of them, men and women alike, was engaged in doing something very meaningful and very useful. They all aim at creating a new sense of unity, a new sense of identity, and they want to have a new Iraq suitable for living, okay, appropriate for living and for their children in the future. Some of them organize themselves in groups to clean the place, to cook, to distribute food, to bake, read the Quran, fundraise, offer medical help, paint, sing, share, talking about politics, entertaining dreams of better future. Of special importance to me was the conspicuous and unprecedented rate of women presence in a clear defiance to the stereotypical roles assigned for women in the private, not public space, which is dominated by men, and also defiance of some religious groups that accuse the protest, especially female, of violating codes of conduct. I'm gonna share some pictures. This is me, of course, in the protest. I have many others. This is another picture by me among the protesters. Of course, later on, I might display other pictures that explain my own participation. The flourish of expression that is on display is significant far beyond its considerable artistic merit. More than just a pleasing display or a suitable background for selfies, the cultural output of Al-Tahrir Square and around-the-clock activities reflect the contours of an emergent political culture divorced from the previous era before 23. This gave rise to what might be termed social and cultural renaissance in the words of historian and writer Fener Haddad. This renaissance takes place in arts and literature in general, and singing, hip hop, and graffiti, or street art in particular. At this stage, I find it very important and useful to give an idea about the history of Iraq, specifically modern Iraq. In fact, after the throwing of monarchy in 1958, Iraq has never known a genuine and real stability. The post-1958 period was marked by internal political and social unrest, regional rivalries, and successive coup d'états culminated in the 1968 when Arab Ba'ath Socialist Party assumed the power. After a long history of political instability and repression, in which politics in Iraq was bathed in bullets and blood and had evolved into a Darwinian struggle to survive. Immediately after its seizure of power, the party embarked on a massive campaign to subjugate and reshape Iraqi society in the image of Saddam Hussein and its regime. In order to achieve this goal, the party adopted a number of aspects typical of the totalitarian systems, which can be grouped as under five closely linked clusters of characteristic features. of course, everything was state controlled, the media, the television, the newspapers, the schools, everything was under strict state and party control. In a seminal study or article entitled Saddam is Iraq and Iraq is Saddam, Naplica talks about very dangerous and alarming aspects in the politics of Iraq, which is known as Saddamism, which typically means the reduction not only of the party, but also of Iraq itself to the figure of the one and only or the necessity leader Saddam Hussein. This implies a gradual and menacing movement from the one party rule to the one man rule and ushers into the emergence of what is called the shadow state, in which Saddam, the dictator, and his narrow inner circle became the sole political, economic, and social movers in the Ba'athist Iraq. This gives rise to what is called cult of personality or self-promotion, which means the use of mass media propaganda and other methods to create an idolized, heroic, and at times worshipful image, often through any questioning, flattery, and praise, as everything was confiscated, okay, and was taken by Saddam Hussein. So we have the bridges of Saddam Hussein, the schools of Saddam Hussein, the, let's say, farms of Saddam Hussein, airports, everything was taken over by Saddam Hussein, as one of our poets had said, who is Adnan al-Sa'ir. Of course, this dictatorship resulted in successive wars, begins with Iran-Iraq War in 1988, and then the Second Gulf War, after the invasion of Kuwait by Saddam Hussein and his regime. Then we have the economic sanction imposed on Iraq by the United Nations as a punishment. Then we have, of course, the collapse of Saddam in 2003. As a result of this dictatorial, regime, of course, there was no freedom of speech and writers in general. We have dominating fear of climate and intimidation, and writers in general were put in front of two choices only, either to write, propagandistic works that praise the president and his regime, his achievement, personality, his wisdom, and so on, or to risk their lives, to risk imprisonment, to risk being kidnapped or disappeared, and so on. To sum up, I'll borrow metaphors from literature. Iraqis indeed were living in society of the Big Brother, as depicted by the British novelist George Orwell in his 1984, and the Republic of Fear. They were living in the Republic of Fear until now, of course, as Adnan Makia described it, and it was, in the words of Hamlet, a big Iraq was a big prison. Let me share with you some, again, pictures. This picture explains, look at, for example, this is among hundreds, maybe millions. There was a joke that says the pictures and posters and portraits of Saddam Hussein are more than the population of Iraqi people. I have hundreds of pictures like these in which we have self-aggrandizing. Saddam is trying to self-aggrandize himself. He's bigger than everyone. He's bigger than all people. Now, for these reasons, the fall, the overthrowing of Saddam and his regime in 23 following the U.S. coalition military campaign was an unbelievable, at the same time, a real historic moment in the lives of Iraqis. Unfortunately, the rosy dreams of Iraqis of liberation, freedom, and prosperity turn out to be nightmares as the country plunges into seas of blood, massive destruction of infrastructure, domination of religious extremism, sectarianism, violence, and bloody power struggle. Meanwhile, side by side with these gloomy portraits of Iraq after 23, we have somehow positive and the brighter portrait of Iraq or picture of Iraq, because what happened in the 23 was decisive in other respects for Iraqis, as it helps to introduce the Iraqis to new lifestyles, the school of thinking, and means of expression. Among the factors that enhance the Iraqis' ability of self-expression are traveling abroad, internet access, and specifically social media. Because social media played a very, very important role in the last protest. Now, people, men, young men and women were very active in sustaining the presence of people in this protest. Now, as for the cultural and social development in the post-23 Iraq, they can be summed up in these points. I'll begin, of course, with something in connection to the religious atmosphere or events. One of the most conspicuous features in post-23 is the public Husseini processions in which Al-Taf battle is reenacted in what theatrically termed Al-Tashabi. These processions were banned during Saddam's rule, but they flourish after 23 as a Shia become an essential actor in the political scene. Husseini Tashabi is usually an open-air theatrical show in which the battle between Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, the prophet of Muhammad, the grandson of the Prophet Muhammad, and Yazid ibn Muawiyah is enacted. In the established narratives, it is a battle between honesty, goodness, faith, purity on the one hand, and dishonesty, corruption, and wickedness on the other hand. The theater is informal in the sense that ordinary people usually volunteer to act the roles in this show. It is something akin to street theater. It is also it is not only a religious event, it is also a cultural event, economic event also. We have with Al-Tashabi, we have the bomb or the flourish of what we call eulogy recitations or eulogy reciters. We call it in Arabic rawadid. One of the most important rawadid or praisers, as we say, middahin, is Basim al-Karbala'i. Basim al-Karbala'i is very famous, and he has succeeded in, for example, he has succeeded in becoming very popular among people. He has millions of followers listening to him, and he is, what distinguishes him is that he is apolitical. He's not political, he's not engaged in politics, and he tries to focus on the tragedies that befall the family of Prophet Muhammad, specifically Imam Hussein and his companions. Also, the period after 23 can be called the period or the age of the novel for Iraqis, as more than 300 or maybe 400 novels were written in this about 20 years. What characterizes these novels is their focus on issues relevant to the history of Iraqi people, geography of Iraqi people, psychology, and society. They focus on explosions, on death, on, for example, sectarian violence, on the, traumatic people who are suffering from psychological shocks and so on. One of the best examples is a novel by Ahmed al-Sa'dawi called The Frankenstein in Baghdad, in a clear reference to Mary Shelley Frankenstein. The Iraqi Frankenstein, we have a creature made of the body parts of the victims of the explosions in Baghdad. Of course, it is very important novel in the sense that it tackles and sheds light on what was going on in Iraq during these very hard and tragic times. Also, another developments we have what we called concerning poetry, not novel. I believe that one of the most important groups that was established after 23 is Militia of Culture Group. Militia of Culture Group is established or was established by a number of young Iraqi poets who seek to introduce a counter-performative act and deals with death as the legitimate father of their existence. Death empowers those poets to deal with the tragedies in texts that dribble with the tragic images of agony and loss. They use very shocking language that is tantamount or equal to the shocking images we find in everyday life. The poetic world of Militia Thaqafa is based on the ruins of collapsing society. Most important of their poems are written in images and language that is made in direct contact with the language of its time. The sites they choose are not ordinary sites because they are anti-establishment, okay, and there is a recitation mixed between performance and going to the actual sites of the poem. So they go, for example, to the minefields, to a nuclear reactor whose walls and surroundings are full of radiations, in the slums where people are forced to live because of poverty and lack of alternatives, in ambulance cars carrying the deformed casualties, in the immigrants' boats of death, and in the hospitals. I might share with you again some pictures. These are the four poets of Militia Al-Thaqafa, and of course they are here reading a poem about the atrocities, let's say, committed by ISIS. We have here, look at the uniform, and we have also the knife, let's say, that stand for the killing, and we can say the massive graves, let's say, the atrocities again, and the tragedies committed by ISIS. I might simply, give you a number of points, the main causes for the protest. First of all, we have high percentage of poverty and unemployment, specifically among the Iraqi population. We have insecurity, economic stagnation, continuous war, state of conflict and war, the noticeable emergence of non-state actors, especially militia-like groups. Adoption of a rule system that is characterized by nepotism, cronyism, and corruption. All these predominate, in fact. The adoption of sectarian political quotas, or what we call al-muhasasa al-ta'afiyya, sectarian apportionment, as a rule system. We also have the nearly complete collapse of infrastructure in terms of housing, schools, roads, transportation, and other public. In fact, people, let's say, have a high sense of insecurity. They are living a little bit in a complete darkness as to the prospects of a future. What kind of government we will have? Will our dreams be realized or not? Everything is kept in the darkness, and we, let's say, rely on fate to save us. As a result of this protest, we have so many activities, social, cultural, and so on. One of them, because again of time limitation, I cannot, let's say, go deep talking about it, is the flourish of the non-governmental organization. We have hundreds of these organizations, and they are playing a very important role in promoting and raising awareness of human rights. I can count you hundreds of these that, for example, pay attention to the displaced, disadvantaged, marshes, for example, to water, pollution, patients, cancer patients, and so on. We have also other social and cultural activities, including establishing libraries, street theatrical shows. We have Al-Tahrir cinema, bazaars for fundraising, festivals for reading, reciting poetry, singing, dancing, for example. We have establishment of radio station named We Want a Homeland Radio. We have also Jawad Salim's Tinnit, Al-Tahrir Beach Festival, Al-Tuk-Tuk newspaper. We can festival and many educative lectures about human rights, Iraqi institutions, and elsewhere. In fact, protests resulted in many young people, let's say, engage in doing various useful activities. We can term the literature and art following the protest, as we say, al-tahrir literature. We have al-tahrir art, as we have many manifestation of arts associated with being there in al-tahrir square. I want also of special importance, I might share one photo about organization, non-governmental organization called Basmat Emel, or an imprint of hope, as we say. These young men and women are members of non-governmental organization called Basmat Emel, or imprint of hope. They engage in painting the walls of Baghdad, specifically the wall, brick walls, okay, that let's say are everywhere in Baghdad. They paint it with colorful colors, and they turn the walls that are very gloomy and bleak into very bright and shiny colors. Portraits and pictures. I move now again to a very, very important and essential aspect in the protest, which is the participation of women. In fact, the presence of women in Tahrir Square is considered one of the most important social changes in post 2019. Their numbers in these protests, in fact, set a record and contribute to fuel the scene with more energy and enthusiasm. Just like men, women belong to various social, economic, and educational backgrounds. Some were veiled, like me, others not. Still more covered their faces in black and white checkered scarves. Most carried roses, Iraqi flags, and or signs, depending their role in the regime change at the demonstration. They engage in performing various tasks, like cleaning, cooking, painting, providing a medical aid. They are indeed promoting, mobilizing, and leading social movement in Iraq. They directly confront deeply rooted traditional and religious gender norms, despite very real threats of violence. Female lawyers and solicitors organize discussion circles to spread awareness of rights of freedom of expression, protected in Article 19 of the Iraqi Constitution. I want to say something concerning this. I believe that both men and women in Iraq are victims to a long history of repression. But the situation of women is worse than men because they are the weaker part, the more vulnerable, disadvantaged part, let's say, in the equation, as we say. The importance of the women, let's say, women presence in Al-Tahrir is threefold. It helps to change the somehow stereotypical image of women that restrict its role to private sphere. It is a clear defiance to some religious views that dictate the segregation between men and women. And it is an act of resistance to a long history of political, tribal, and social oppression. the main problem suffered by, let's say, Iraqi women, and I believe not it is not inclusive of Iraqi society, but in many other societies. First of all, for example, we have the high rate of unemployment. It means that women do not have economic revenues, income, that make her enjoy independence. Second, we have the high rate of illiteracy among more than among men. We have the problem of minor age. Girls less than 18 and less than 16 and 15 are married off to men because of economic situation, sometimes for social reasons, they are married off. Sometimes because of a tribal, let's say, convictions and so on, some people and some families disinherited the woman. They do not give her share in the, for example, the money of her father, of her late father or deceased father, saying that woman, let's say, should not take money. It is men's, not a woman's money, and so on. That is why they participate and they call for a change in the laws, in the, for example, social customs and so on. One of them, there are many slogans that they emphasize. The demands of women, for example, this one, revolt, resist, and smile because you are the nation. Okay, emphasizing the equality between men and women. The revolution will be completed by you. No revolution is complete without the presence and participation of women. Again, another revolution is my name. Male silence is the real shame. They chanted, then adding freedom, revolution, feminism. These are your daughters, oh homeland. They are carrying the banners. I'm loyal to my homeland, not you. Who are you? You know, of course, when you translate from Arabic into English, there is a great loss in terms of rhythm, in terms even of the meaning and so on. But I try. Another important development here is the graffiti and murals. Graffiti and murals. Of course, painting on the public walls is not a new phenomenon. However, they gain in importance as a means of expression and resistance. As soon as the protest erupted, many artists, specifically young girls and young men, began a massive scale campaign to paint on the walls of Al-Tahrir Square Tunnel. The images are both haunting and inspiring, transforming a once dreary grim underpass into a vivid, colorful wall of art. One of the painting graffiti says, "We want a nation, not a prison." Okay, and we have in this graffiti a man pointing, a man bursting free from behind bars. Another says, "Plant a nation and you will harvest a plant a revolution and you will harvest a nation," reads another graffiti showing a hand flashing the victory sign over protesters' heads. Along its walls, young artists draw murals, portraits, and graffiti that illustrates the country's tortured past and the Iraq they aspire to. Caricatures on the walls mock Iraqi politicians. Other paintings praise the tuk-tuk drivers. A woman with an Iraqi flag on her cheek flexes her bicep, recreating the famed US, "We can do it, we can do it." Poster, faces in drawings shout in anger and pain. Another, we say, "We are life makers, not death makers. We decided to draw simple painting to support our brothers and express our message, which is a peace message." The murals and the graffiti were calling for peace. They were anti-violence and anti-justice. Walls speak loudly. These murals, just like the revolution, will not die. the murals engage in asking the same questions Iraqis ask. Why Iraqi protesters who are demanding rights are killed? They try to create a common space between the content and the spectators. They become symbols for the Iraqi. And as for the symbols, we have many. Specifically, we have the Turkish restaurant, which is called the Jebel Uhud, or the Mountain of Uhud, in a clear historical reference to a battle between the infidel in the early years of Islam establishment, between the infidel and the Muslim society or army, sorry, led by Prophet Muhammad. Also, we have the Iraqi flag, we have the Iraqi map, we have, tuk-tuk, we have the Joker. The age itself, the generation itself is what's called the generation of Bobji, because in this we have a clear reference to the impact of video games on people. Now, in the first, of course, politician and the government treat the protesters and the protests lightly. Besides all these developments, I believe all of them succeeded in creating a very vibrant, a very interesting, let's say, a very attractive scene. There is movement all the time, you know, movement in everyday life. There is all the time this movement from cultural to social to political. Iraqi are engaged in talking about all these matters. We have one of important, aspects or results of the protest in the field of songs and the rap. Of course, rap was not known before 2010. It was restricted to a small group of young men. But after the protest and after the singing the rap song, which became popular, many people, many specifically young people, began to sing rap songs and to sing patriotic songs, praising the protesters, praising the new spirit of unity, the new spirit of Iraqiness, as we might say. Let me give you an idea, about the songs before 23, and then comment on the songs post 23. Historically speaking, politically critical music has been very risky in Iraq, specifically in Saddam's era. Songs had until fairly recently been limited to praising ruling officials, particularly the late President Saddam Hussein. They praised his wars, his leadership, his wisdom, and so on. After 23, patriotic songs, become very popular. But again, they retain the same characteristic. They are highly militarized in the sense that, for example, the singers wear military uniform. They focus on and were dedicated to specific occasions such as elections, the war on terrorism, urging fighters to eliminate the Islamic State or ISIS, and so on. The language of these songs is very violent. They are all the time talking about crushing, killing, let's say, tearing apart the enemy, gorging the eyes, and so on. Very shocking and very aggressive language and images we have. The popular tunes that have emerged in Iraqi protests are completely different from the other songs. They openly address, for example, Iranian interference in Iraq and the crises that afflict society. They talk about poverty. They talk about the, for example, destruction of Iraq in general. They talk about the coward politicians. They borrow both from Western styles and traditional Iraqi music with its melancholic tunes. Iraqi three top rap stars, Sakt, Hamid, and Enhar, were all born in the 90s, 19. So they are very young. They have lived through the wars and political crises that Iraq experienced during the past two decades, and know all too well the pains and challenges of every day life in Iraq. Listen to this song, for example. In one of these songs, Enhar says, "We generation of revenge. We are generation of revolution, revolution of liberators. I do not carry guns. My weapons are my ideas and thoughts," again emphasizing the peacefulness of the revolution and the right of Iraqi people of a better life. The revolutionary Iraq pays homage to Iraqi millennials, those young, less than 20 years old people who stay at night in Al-Tahrir Square, who are ready to sacrifice themselves for the sake of their country. Those millennials have been on the protest in 11 governorates in southern and central Iraq. Now, besides the young demonstrators, the rappers also praise women as the primary force of the demonstrations, as well as the tuk-tuk drivers who have taken the injured to the hospitals. Some condemn those who have chosen to go to work and university, while striking protesters are getting killed and injured. Rap music has become more popular in Iraq over the past few years, partly because two of the most famous satirical Iraqi programs. Of course, Iraq before 23 is completely different from Iraq after 23. For example, before, we do not have those talk shows, as we say. The first program is Al-Bashir Show, and the second is Wilayat Batif or Awata Liman Estate. Both of them include rap segments. One of the songs that was featured on Al-Bashir Show is entitled Dayl A'waj, a twisted tail, and tail here is a simple. It is sung by Ayman Hamad. This song took off among demonstrators in the last few months. In colloquial Iraqi Arabic, tail means puppet, as in a politician who is the lackey, the servant of external groups, and sells out his own nation's and his own homeland's interests. In this song, he says, "He hates our gatherings. He does because he is a tail. He is a puppet, tail." And we have repetition of the word tail. "He gives up on his families and his people. It is a twisted. He is a tail. Who can make it street? It's tail. Bringing snipers on me and showing himself proud before the neighbors." These are the words of one of these songs. Again, we have the revolution, in fact, changed everything. It even changed the musical tunes Iraqi people listen to, specifically young generation. The young Iraqi, for example, rapper Enhar, has YouTube and where he uploads work mixing loud Western music with Iraqi flavor. He includes pictures of Iraqi politicians while his lyrics criticize them harshly. Explicit and anti-Iranian, one of the songs also refers to Iran's tales in Iraq, meaning Iraqi political leaders who have extensive ties with Iran. Of course, the rap songs, in fact, are overtly political. They emphasize, let's say, issues related to politics in Iraq. As for the symbols, of course, Tuk-Tuk figure out in Al-Tahrir. Symbols, we have Sa'du Tunnel, the Tuk-Tuk, the Square, the Turkish restaurant, let's say, which the protesters took over. Let's say, all of them become very important symbols. We have also some semiological tools, okay, that become very clear in the protest, such as Iraqi flag, map, fans, dust bins, shoes, pictures of martyrs and detainees, Che Guevara pictures, flowers, tombs, okay. The main language, again, something I have to say, were standard and vernacular Arabic, English. This is in graffiti, in, for example, slogans, in the banners and so on. We have Arabic vernacular and standard. We have English and Kurdish and others, of course, even Sumerian. The parties, for example, which the protesters targeted were specifically the prime minister, the MPs, the officials in the government, and so on. As for the Tuk-Tuk, first of all, in fact, me including, many people in Baghdad and in provinces feel ashamed. They are rather reluctant to get in the Tuk-Tuk to transport them from one place to another. Drivers are mostly poor people. They are coming from a very disempowered, very marginalized region, like, for example, Al-Sadr or Al-Thawra city. Rate of poverty there is very high, and people depend on mostly on menial jobs in sustaining their lives. First of all, as I told you, Tuk-Tuk was rather unpopular among Iraqis, but after the protest and the heroic role played by the Tuk-Tuk drivers, for example, in transporting people from one place to another because of the many checkpoints, many brick walls that separates the and divides region of Baghdad, specifically in Al-Tahrir Square. We have Al-Khilani on the one side, we have Al-Sa'dun Tunnel on the other side, we have Al-Sinek Bridge and so on. These Tuk-Tuk become very popular. They become a symbol of liberation, symbol of heroism, for example, symbol of Iraqiness, of unity and so on. They even become artifacts in the sense that, for example, girls make them earrings, necklaces, for example, they are sold as toys for young children. So somehow, just like an industrial item, as we say, industrial item, commercial item, they become very, very popular. And the image and the attitude towards the tuk-tuk and their drivers become very, very positive after the protest because of their positive and patriotic role in the protest. Of course, we have other symbols. We have borrowing of historical and ancient symbols. For example, Masalat Hammurabi, as we say, it was used in the protest. We have, for example, a reference to the line of Babylon. We have, again, borrowing of songs, borrowing of symbols from history of Iraq, previous history of Iraq, and so on. Again, of course, as for slogans, I can tell you about many slogans. All of them emphasize the unity of Iraq. Among these slogans is, yes, women can. You are the revolution and they are the pudendum, awra. Iraq unites us, the politicians divide, steal, and kill us. Do not let Iraq down. All these are slogans, okay, in the banners. No complete revolution without women. Cowards, I do like this. Cowards do not make history. Cowards do not make history. I do like this slogan. It's very indeed inspiring and significant. I want a homeland. I do not want blood. Free our sons, our fathers, our brothers. Enough is enough. We no longer want reform or services of you. You don't get, you can't get blood out of stones. You are corrupted, sectarian, leave us alone. You steal us, but you will never enslave us. We want a civil Iraq and so on. Of course, the changes that take place, they take place in all fields of life. For example, in the language, we have many words, okay, new words, neologism, enter the Iraqi language. Among them, for example, of course, we have sakak, which means a killer. We have allas, which means informer. We have fayakh in Iraqi colloquial language, which means rich. We have hawasim, those who squat the places and loot immediately after 23. They occupy lands and they build houses on them and so on. We have, for example, al-zahuf. We have al-zahuf wal-lahuq, which means a flatterer, hypocrite, woman's hunter, and so on. We have fasl, we have remishli, because you know of the internet, mobile phone, as we say, introduction to Iraqi society. I want, before concluding these points, I want to read a poem by Al-Tahrir. And I want to say, well, this is among my conclusion, is that these protests give rise to what we call the informal literature, informal art. We might call them underground art, underground literature, because previously unknown artists, unknown poets, unknown writers become very popular, okay, among people, and they are known because of the protests. What helps them is the social media, blogging, for example, Twitter, Facebook, and so on, Instagram, and so on. One of the, of course, these poems I choose is Next Time, the title, by Nawras al-Jabri. Somehow the topic is interesting because she says in it, you have to kiss me in the Turkish restaurant. This is something rather strange said by a woman in a very conservative society like Iraqi, asking her lover to kiss her in a Turkish restaurant. Or in the demonstration yards, or on the fire barrier. which separates us from death. You have to kiss me under the hail of bullets or the shower of tear gas, on the footsteps of those running away. We will stand steadfast with a kiss. You have to hug me under the Freedom Monument, during chanting and after, in El Sa'doun tunnel, or in the tuk-tuk, if you will, in front of our favorite portrait. You have to hug me endlessly. You have to do it extravagantly. There are no side effects for hugging, save addiction and habituation. Whisper, I love you, in my ear, and I get your wound assured it is all right. The next time, terrify me with a bigger wound to increase my fear and to ripen all this love in me. Never wear a gas mask. Let my mouth be responsible for saving you. If you suffocate, wrap your neck with this flag, the Iraqi flag, to feel I am with you. Looking always in your hand for mine. And if you couldn't find it, the ring will tell you. The next time you have to return to kissing and hugging, or to take me with you, you have to turn in with a full head, without me or life dripping of it. I hate your head being occupied by other things than me, and this gas bomb does not fit in with your head. You see, all what we call the Al-Tahrir images, symbols, events are here included in this poem. Now, my dear listeners, thank you and sorry for taking this long time. In conclusion, the first thing I want to say is that Iraq, before October protest 2019, is different from Iraqi after it. There are many changes. The protest helped to change many things in the life of Iraqis, in the politically speaking, culturally speaking, and let's say socially speaking. But there is a lot still to be achieved. We are waiting for a lot of things to be changed, to be modified. Now, one of the, results of Iraqi protests here is that they are the first united nationwide uprising in the country in recent memory. Protesters have exhibited, showed admirable levels of discipline and have been exemplars of the principle that practical anti-oppression and the struggle for proletarian power are inseparable. Second, the culture of solidarity, inclusivity, and self-help that has sustained Tahrir Square is itself a major achievement. Tahrir Square becomes a home to everything from civic activism to musical events to tribal processions and religious rituals. The protests give rise for a new generation of singers, writers, players, actors, bloggers, unknown before. Internet and social media help them to express themselves and communicate their messages. The revolution itself contributes to rectify and correct the inferior view to parts of society like menial job workers, glorification of previously despised tuk-tuk drivers, and more important, women whose role was highly appreciated. Again, the protests are highly controversial. Till now, some of them, some describe them as a revolution, some as uprising, some call describe it as illegitimate, some legitimate. They are highly controversial in the sense that they affect discussion on all levels in Iraqi society about politics, about the future of Iraq, about what do we want exactly? What do we want exactly? Because the situation is very chaotic, is very messy, taking into consideration not only the internal conditions or circumstances, but also the pressure from the outside world, outside the actors, again, the pressure because of Corona, because of the stagnation of economy, because of the decrease in the oil prices and so on. There are many problems, there are many challenges, but actually there are no real solutions to these problems and the challenges. That is why, as an outlet, as a means, Iraqis, for example, resort to social media to express their views, to songs, to reading, to activities that they feel themselves in, because they feel that they are too helpless, too powerless to effect a real change in their society. Once again, I have many, many things to say, many, many important points to say, many persons I want to talk. For example, I want to talk about Riham Yaqub, who was killed. She's a very great activist and a doctor at the same time in Al-Basra. I want to talk about Iraqi women, great Iraqi women, like, for example, Ali Mohammed Bakr, who saves more than 30,000 books in Al-Basra National Library. I want to talk about Umqusay, who helps to save 30 soldiers, Iraqi soldiers, from ISIS, okay? About many, many activists, about many, I want to talk about my students, for example, who are with me in the protests. They were with me and many of them participated and many of them want better Iraq, want better education, better housing they are dreaming of. I want to talk about all these, but because of time limitation, I focus on these points. Thank you once again for giving me this chance, and I hope that my presentation was as interesting for you as possible and as useful as possible. Thank you, Annette, for this invitation, and thank you, all of you, my dear.